Journey to the Cross, Day 22. On this side of eternity, it is easy to love the gift more than the giver. Parents instinctively know that issuing warnings is an important part of true love. Parents who love their children spend a lot of time over the years warning them. From the early warnings about things that are hot, sharp, dirty, or poisonous, to the later warnings about the temptations of a fallen world, one of the ways that parents regularly express their love for their children is by warning them of the dangers ahead. I have two granddaughters, and when I am with them, I find myself doing this all the time. Sometimes those warnings are attached to the rules that children have been taught and asked to obey. These warnings carry with them the threat of consequences or judgment. But warnings are not the same as judgment. If all I wanted to do was judge you, I wouldn't warn you. I warn you because I love you, and I don't want you to have to experience the consequences of your disobedience. When you are warned, you are being loved. To be warned is to receive grace. Scripture warns us about a subtle kind of idolatry that masquerades as the worship of God, but is really driven by the love of things. The war between worship of God and worship of things is not always as apparent to us as we think. A seminary professor of mine told of a moment in his church when his brothers and sisters were enjoying a time of public praise. One woman stood up and shared how she had been facing bills that she could not pay, and that she prayed and that God had supplied the money necessary to pay them all. Then she said, "I'm just so thankful to God for his faithfulness." It seems that everything was right in this moment of praise, except my professor kept thinking, what if he hadn't? What if God, for his eternal glory and her spiritual good, had allowed her to face the stress of an even greater financial consequences of those bills being unpaid? Would she have still stood up and thanked God for his faithfulness? Now, it may seem like a judgmental way of hearing this woman's gratitude, but the professor's observation points us to how subtle and deceptive the war for our hearts can be. Could it be that we are most excited about God's presence in our lives when he has met a physical need or delivered to us something that we want? Could it be that there are ways in which God has been reduced from the one that we love to the deliverer of the thing that we love? Could it be that love of the world masquerades in our hearts as worship of God? After we get what we want and we thank God for it, we think we are worshiping him, but perhaps in reality, what has captured our hearts is not God, but a thing. The world around us is filled with sight, sound, touch, and taste attractions. We also find delights that are not physical, like affection, success, position, respect, power, and control. All of these created things, both material and immaterial, appear to give us life. They seem to have the power to produce joy and satisfaction, or when absent, sadness and discontent. So it is quite tempting to reach for them, hoping they will do for us what they were never intended to do. It is tempting for all of us to look around and say, if I only had blank, then my life would be blank. Whatever sits on the other side of your if only is the thing you are living for at that moment, and the thing that you think will give you the piece of life that you think is missing. Consider these heart-revealing questions. When does God excite me the most? When do I shout the loudest, God loves me? When am I most thankful that I am one of God's children and the object of his fathering care? When does my relationship with God provide me the most joy? What does God need to do for me in order for me to be content? When do I question God's love? When do I struggle the most to believe that God is faithful? When am I tempted to envy others or to think God has favorites? When does my praise of the Lord feel empty? What causes me to feel that my prayers go unheard? What would God have to do to produce real joy in me? I don't know about you, but I find these questions to be uncomfortable and revealing. I don't think of myself as the one who loves the gift more than the giver, but perhaps there are ways in which I do. Do I really believe that God is good, does what is good, and gives what is good to all his children all the time? Is it really true of me that because of the joy and satisfaction of knowing him and being loved by him, I am able to live with plenty or live with want? Does withholding of what seems good cause me to question if he is good? Can I stand next to someone who has what I think I need and still love my Lord and rest in his love for me? Are there things that I have set my heart on, the absence of which will cause my faith to waver and my praise to be silenced? Where does my heart still live under the rulership of the gift, rather than the righteous and loving rule of the giver? During this season, when you are letting go of the things of the world, confessing areas of sin and weakness, and running to your Savior for rescue and help, perhaps you should also confess one of the subtlest forms of idolatry. Perhaps it will be good to confess that what appears as worship may not be worship at all. It may be worship of the thing that reduces God to the delivery system for what your heart really craves. And remember, God sent His Son not only to forgive our sins, but also to liberate our hearts from the bondage to anything but Him. He is not shocked or disgusted by your struggle. He will not turn away from you, but toward you with love and grace. So today, hear this loving warning. Could it be that the confession of ongoing struggles of idolatry, no matter how subtle, is the first step toward a heart that is consumed by the worship of God alone?